Then let us move on to the next group of drugs, direct thrombin inhibitors. Differ from indirect thrombin inhibitors that these drugs do not take the help of antithrombin. They directly inhibit thrombin. Under that we have the examples, hirudin, lipiridin, bivaluridin, etc. So as I told you, hirudin is directly obtained from a natural source, that is Hirudo medicinalis, that is a medicinal leech. Whereas lipiridin, desiridin are recombinant forms of this hirudin. They are the developed by recombinant DNA technology. And bivaluridin and ergatroban are purely synthetic. And here this ergatroban is a small molecule. Ergatroban is a small molecule, synthetic small molecule. So when it comes to the mechanism of action, they directly inhibit the thrombin without seeking the help of antithrombin. That is what is the fundamental difference between the indirect heparins and indirectly acting thrombin inhibitors like heparin and directly acting thrombin inhibitors like hirudin, bivaluridin, etc. So these direct thrombin inhibitors do not require the help of antithrombin. They directly inhibit thrombin. And they also inactivate free thrombin as well as fibrin bound thrombin. This is another difference. Heparin does not have any effect on the thrombin that is bound to fibrin, but these direct thrombin inhibitors can inactivate free thrombin as well as fibrin bound thrombin, and this is going to be irreversible, and this inhibition is irreversible. And as I told you, they do not require the help of antithrombin 3. And another important advantage is that these direct thrombin inhibitors, they do not have much interaction with platelets, or it does not suppress, or it does not have as much bleeding activity as that of heparin. These are the important advantages. Now, some important points to note with regard to these drugs are, lipiridin and desiridin should not be used, or rather they should be used very carefully in patients with renal failure. Lipiridin and desiridin should be used very carefully, that is a special precaution, that is renal failure. Whereas ergatroban can be safely used, this can be safely used in case of renal failure, because this is a small molecule and it doesn't have much a problem. And like heparin, which is monitored by estimating APTT, all these direct thrombin inhibitors should also be monitored by measuring activated partial thromboplastin levels. This is one important point that can be similar to the monitoring of heparin. And these drugs are mainly indicated for the treatment of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia, treatment of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. As I told you before, the adverse effect of one anticoagulant is treated with another anticoagulant. So direct thrombin inhibitors like lipiridin are most importantly indicated for heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. And heparin has an antidote, but in case of overdoses, this doesn't have an antidote. Direct thrombin inhibitors, as of now, they are not having any antidote. That is the most important point. I think this was asked number of times before. So all these lipiridin, bivaluridin, ergatroban, etc., they are given by parenteral route. As I told you before, during the classification, direct thrombin inhibitors are having some drugs that are given by parenteral route and some drugs that are given by oral route. So all indirect thrombin inhibitors are administered only by parenteral route. All direct factor 10A inhibitors are administered only by oral route. All vitamin K antagonists are given by oral route. Whereas direct thrombin inhibitors, some of them are given by parenteral route and some of them are given by oral route. So what are these orally administered direct thrombin inhibitors? We have two important examples. They are dabigatran and zimelagatran. So these dabigatran and zimelagatran are having longer duration of action. They act for a longer time and they are approved for the prevention of thrombosis in non-valvular atrial fibrillation. So prevention of thrombosis in non-valvular atrial fibrillation. Dabigatran and Zemlagatran are mainly used for the treatment of to prevent the thrombotic tendencies in non-valvular atrial fibrillation. And they are also used in case of venous thromboembolism. And with regard to drug interactions, dabigatran is a substrate for P-glycoprotein. So that means drugs that induce or inhibit P-glycoprotein are known to interact with dabigatran, and they may increase the levels of dabigatran or decrease the levels of dabigatran. That is what is the most important part to be noted with regard to dabigatran. So we have rifampicin, which induces the P-glycoprotein, so that may interact with dabigatran, and we have inhibitors like clarithromycin or viral protease inhibitors. They inhibit P-glycoprotein, so they may also interact in the opposite way with the dabigatran. Then the next group of drugs are direct factor 10A inhibitors. Direct factor 10A inhibitors, they are all administered by oral route, and as I told you before, their names contain XA, like apixaban, rivaroxaban, edoxaban, etc. The advantages with these new oral anticoagulants, so these are called new oral anticoagulants. What are the traditional anticoagulants? Vitamin K antagonists. But new oral anticoagulants are direct factor 10A inhibitors like apixaban, edoxaban, etc. and direct thrombin inhibitors like dabigatran, zemlagatran, etc. So these are called new oral anticoagulants. So the advantages being, monitoring is not much required, especially in case of factor 10A inhibitors. And all these are substrates for CYP3A4. So we have many inducers and many inhibitors for CYP3A4. What I would like to tell you is, because these direct factor 10A inhibitors are substrates for CYP3A4, there may be many drug interactions as supposed to be expected from inducers of CYP3A4 or inhibitors of CYP3A4. Let us review what are the inducers for CYP3A4 first. So phenytoin, carbamazepine, rifampicin, St. John's wort, all these are inducers of rifampicin, barbiturates, carbamazepine, phenytoin, St. John's wort, all these are inducers for CYP3A4. They may enhance the metabolism of factor 10A inhibitors, leading to decreased anticoagulant activity. Then we have inhibitors like erythromycin, clarithromycin, itraconazole, then HIV viral protease inhibitors, cimetidine. All these are inhibitors of CYP3A4. So when these are combined along with factor 10A inhibitors, these inhibitors of CYP3A4 may inhibit the metabolism of factor 10A inhibitors, and that may lead to increased anticoagulant activity of factor 10A inhibitors, and that may lead to more bleeding. So coming to the indications, the indications are similar to the direct thrombin oral inhibitors like zemlagatran or dabigatran. The indications are more or less similar in case of factor 10A inhibitors are also. They are non-valvular atrial fibrillation. Then deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, and prophylaxis for knee or hip surgeries. More or less all these anticoagulants, because they are anticoagulants, they have got more or less common applications like prophylaxis for knee or hip surgeries, deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, valvular. Suppose if the patient has prosthetic heart valves, so that may lead to excess coagulation, and that may be leading to even embolism, especially pulmonary embolism or other embolisms. So that is why these drugs are mainly indicated to prevent thrombotic tendencies. Next, so finally, let us review what are the important advantages of new oral anticoagulants. They have got rapid action, they have got less bleeding, their monitoring is not much required unless traditional and unlike traditional anticoagulants like heparin, and they have less drug interactions. See, these are the important advantages: rapid action, less bleeding, less requirement for monitoring, and less drug interactions. And finally, we have some important agents that are newly developed, important new drugs that are used for reversal, new drugs that are developed for reversal of anticoagulant action of various anticoagulants. So we have Idarucizumab. So this is the specific antidote for dabigatran. This is specific for dabigatran. Now we have andexanet alpha. This andexanet alpha mainly is useful to inhibit or to reverse the anticoagulant activity of all oral direct factor 10A inhibitors like apixaban, rivaroxaban, edoxaban, etc. So andexanet alpha is specific antidote for reversal of anticoagulant activity of factor 10A inhibitors, And we have the recently developed drug, that is siraparentag. So these are the important new drugs that are developed recently. So this has got a kind of broad spectrum of effects, broad spectrum of activity. That means it can be used to reverse the actions of dabigatran, and it can be used to reverse the actions of factor 10A inhibitors, and it can inhibit or it can be used to reverse the action of traditional anticoagulants like heparin and low molecular weight heparins. But remember, fondaparinux does not have, it is still not having a specific antidote, because protamine can reverse fully the high molecular weight heparin, it can partially reverse low molecular weight heparins, but it cannot be useful for the reversal of fondaparinux. So idarucizumab is specific for dabigatran, andexanet alpha is specific for factor 10A inhibitors, and siraparentag is for dabigatran, for 10A inhibitors, as well as for high molecular weight heparin, as well as low molecular weight heparin. Now let us move on to the important traditional anticoagulant drug, vitamin K inhibitor, vitamin K antagonist. The prototypical drug is warfarin. The typical example is warfarin. So, as I told you before, factor 2, 7, 9 and 10 are the important clotting factors that are dependent on vitamin K for their synthesis as well as for their activation. So, exactly this is inhibited by the traditional or older anticoagulant drug warfarin. So warfarin, unlike heparin, acts only in vivo. Heparin can act in vitro as well as in vivo, but warfarin can act only in vivo. It is not active in vitro. Then the exact mechanism includes warfarin interferes with the synthesis of vitamin K dependent clotting factors exactly by inhibiting the gamma carboxylation of glutamate residues. Present on the clotting factors 2, 7, 9 and 10. So the exact mechanism of action of warfarin is, it acts by inhibiting the gamma carboxylation of glutamate residues present on factors 2, 7, 9 and 10. So the important significance of this is, this gamma carboxylation is an important and critical step that is necessary for not only activation of these clotting factors, but also required for them to bind with calcium, and then only the coagulation cascade or coagulation sequence will proceed. So the important critical step is gamma carboxylation of glutamate residues, that is exactly inhibited by the reduced form of the vitamin K. And in contrast to heparin, which has got immediate action, warfarin has delayed action, because the mechanism of action of warfarin is to inhibit the synthesis of clotting factors. It doesn't have any effect on the clotting factors that are already synthesized and circulating. So if you use warfarin now, what will happen? It starts to inhibit the synthesis of 2, 7, 9 and 10 clotting factors. But it has nothing to do with the clotting factors that are already circulating in the plasma. So for the action of warfarin to manifest, all the circulating clotting factors which are already synthesized and circulating, they have to disappear. Then only the action of warfarin will manifest. In other words, since the warfarin has only the action to inhibit the synthesis of clotting factors, and it has nothing to do with the clotting factors that are already synthesized and circulating, warfarin is not inhibiting them directly. It is only inhibiting further synthesis of clotting factors. So even if you use warfarin now, the action cannot immediately occur because of the availability of the clotting factors, which are already present in the plasma because they are already synthesized before. So the action of warfarin is delayed. And another important consequence of this is, so different clotting factors have different half-lives. For example, clotting factor 7 has a half-life of 6 hours, 9 has a half-life of 24 hours, 10 has a half-life of 40 hours, and factor 2 has a half-life of 60 hours. That means when you administer heparin, the first factor to disappear is factor 7, and the last factor to disappear is prothrombin. Okay, then we have an important anticoagulant factor. We have an important natural anticoagulant factor. So you know that there are not only clotting factors, there are also anticlotting factors like antithrombin 3, antithromboplastin, then protein C and protein S. So we have the most important clinical significance here, protein C. So protein C is also having, protein C is an anticoagulant. So this has got opposite action on clotting factors. Protein C is an anticoagulant, and it has got very short half-life, around 4 to 5 hours. So what will happen? Your purpose of administering warfarin is to inhibit the synthesis of clotting factors. But that is happening depending upon the clotting factor. So first disappearing is factor 7, like that. So the last one is factor 2. It takes a longer time because it has got a longer half-life. So what happens is, before the inhibition of clotting factors, there is immediate inhibition of anti-clotting factor, that is protein C. So what will happen when there is inhibition of this one? There will be decreased anticoagulant activity of protein C that will lead to increased coagulation. So that is why warfarin administration will immediately after warfarin administration, there may be increase in the clotting tendency. That is why we should not use warfarin alone for the treatment of pulmonary embolism or deep vein thrombosis. We have to always combine it with an immediate acting drug like heparin. So we have to produce immediate anticoagulant effect by giving heparin, and warfarin has to be added slowly, and it is mainly used for maintenance therapy. So the immediate consequence of warfarin administration is there may be transient increase in the hypercoagulability because of the inhibition of anticoagulant protein C. Then we have two types of warfarin, S warfarin and R warfarin. So S warfarin is more active and is mainly metabolized by CYP2C19. And this warfarin has got another important significance, that it has near 100% oral bioavailability. Warfarin is highly plasma protein bound, and it has got high oral bioavailability, almost near to 100%. 97% is the plasma protein binding. And it is an important example that comes under drug that obey zero order kinetics or mixed order kinetics. So phenytoin, aspirin, tolbutamide, warfarin, these are all the drugs that are to be administered carefully, because within the higher therapeutic range, their order of elimination changes from first order to zero order and they become dangerous. And another important contraindication, as I have told you, is pregnancy. Warfarin crosses the placenta and may cause bad effects or severe adverse effects on the fetus. So coming to the uses, as usual, deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism. But remember, when you are using this warfarin for deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism, we have to simultaneously add heparin and low molecular weight heparins to immediately induce anticoagulant effect. But that will be maintained over a period of time by heparin. So atrial fibrillation, deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism, and artificial heart valves and myocardial infarction. These are the important indications. So atrial fibrillation to prevent thrombosis in artificial heart valves and myocardial infarction. These are the important indications for the use of warfarin. Coming to the adverse effects, being an anticoagulant, what you can expect is bleeding, obviously. So the bleeding may manifest as ecchymosis, epistaxis, hematuria, GI bleeding, and severe intracranial bleeding. So it may manifest as ecchymosis, epistaxis, hematuria, GI bleeding, and even intracranial hemorrhage. And the most important danger is to the fetus when it is administered in pregnancy. Fetal hemorrhagic disorder. Fetal hemorrhagic disorder. And it may also lead to fetal warfarin syndrome. Fetal warfarin syndrome. It is characterized by, fetal warfarin syndrome is characterized by bone deformities, growth retardation, mottling of bones, epiphysis, etc. Bone deformities, mottling of bones, growth retardation, etc. Then cutaneous necrosis is another important adverse effect. Cutaneous necrosis. So this is attributed to reduced protein C. So as I told you, protein C is an important anticoagulant factor. It is an important anti-clotting factor. So that is inhibited simultaneously by warfarin. So that will lead to increased thrombosis. So that will lead to cutaneous necrosis and even frank infarction of breast, adipose tissue, intestines, and all these are attributed to depletion of protein C. Coming to the treatment. So in case of warfarin overdoses, how to save the patient from severe bleeding or other adverse effects? So here comes the strange aspect. Usually, specific antidote will be life-saving, or it should be the first drug of choice for the treatment of poisonings. For the treatment of poisoning or overdoses by any drug, if the specific antidote is available, that is supposed to be the first preferred drug or first drug of choice. But surprisingly, in case of warfarin poisoning, even though we have specific antidote available in the form of vitamin K, but the first choice to be, or first choice of drug is, or first choice that is to be administered is not vitamin K. It is fresh frozen plasma. Fresh frozen plasma. Then prothrombin complex concentrate. Prothrombin complex concentrate, and we have recombinant factor 7A. Recombinant factor 7A. So prothrombin complex concentrate is nothing but the complex of all the four factors that are dependent on vitamin K, 2, 7, 9 and 10. So here I would like to repeat again, even though vitamin K is supposed to be the specific antagonist for warfarin poisoning, but this is not the first drug to be given. First drug to be given is fresh frozen plasma or other drugs, because even though vitamin K is specific antidote, what is its mechanism of action? It stimulates the synthesis of clotting factors 2, 7, 9 and 10 so that they can reverse the action of vitamin K. But this synthesis cannot happen immediately. It is not an instantaneous process. It takes a longer time. So to immediately replenish the depleted clotting factors that are inactivated by warfarin, we have to straight away supplement the fresh frozen plasma or prothrombin complex concentrate having all these four factors. So exactly, vitamin K is given in the form of vitamin K1 phytonadione. That is the specific antidote, but that is to be given only after administration of fresh frozen plasma. Now coming to the monitoring of warfarin effect. How the effect of warfarin, anticoagulant effect of warfarin is monitored. So that is monitored by measuring the INR. INR stands for International Normalized Ratio, and this is calculated by PT of the observed, that means prothrombin time of the patient, by the PT of the control. That means prothrombin time of the sample, that is control means the prothrombin time of the pooled plasma. Prothrombin time of the pooled plasma sample. So PT, prothrombin time of the patient, that is PT of the observed means prothrombin time of the patient, by prothrombin time of the control, that is normal pooled plasma, to the power of ISI, International Sensitivity Index. International Sensitivity Index. International Normalized Ratio is equal to prothrombin time of the patient or observed by the prothrombin time of the control, that is normal pool plasma, to the power of ISI. International Sensitivity Index is supplied by the manufacturer. So it is the International Sensitivity Index of the reagent antithromboplastin. So that is what is the exact formula by which we can monitor the anticoagulant effect of warfarin. And in case of most of the patients, our target is to have the INR of 2 to 3. So the recommended INR in most of the patients is 2 to 3, but in case of patients suffering from pulmonary embolism or deep vein thrombosis, severe thrombosis, we can relax it to a higher level. In the sense, we expect, or it is ideal to have 3 to 4.5. So in case of most of the patients, the INR that is expected is, or it has to be maintained between 2 to 3. And in case of patients suffering from deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism, we have to maintain it between 3 to 4.5. Coming to the drug interactions. So there are many drug interactions with warfarin, and warfarin is known for many drug interactions. That is the reason for which it is less preferred anticoagulant nowadays. And let us look at the list of drugs that interact with warfarin with the help of slide. So coming to the drug interactions of warfarin, so we have got number of MCQs from this table especially. So these drug interactions are predominantly divided into two types: drugs that interact to increase the prothrombin time, and drugs that interact with warfarin to decrease prothrombin time. Again, each one is divided into pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic mechanisms. For example, if you see the first list of drugs under pharmacokinetic mechanisms which increase the prothrombin time, we have cimetidine, metronidazole, fluconazole, phenylbutazone, cotrimoxazole, and amiodarone. So all these drugs inhibit the metabolism of warfarin. So when the metabolism of warfarin is inhibited, that leads to increased anticoagulant activity of warfarin. That will increase prothrombin time. So this increased prothrombin time or increased anticoagulant activity of warfarin is due to inhibition of the metabolism of warfarin by all these drugs. So because they are inhibiting the metabolism, that is considered as a pharmacokinetic type of drug interaction. Then drugs that increase the prothrombin time by interacting with warfarin by a pharmacodynamic interaction are aspirin, heparin, cefepirazone, cefamandol, apixaban, dabigatran, etc. For example, aspirin has antiplatelet activity by itself. Heparin has anticoagulant activity by itself. Cefepirazone, cefamandol inhibit prothrombin, and they may lead to increased bleeding. So apixaban and dabigatran, apixaban is a direct factor 10A inhibitor and dabigatran is direct thrombin inhibitor, which is administered by oral route. So all these drugs increase the anticoagulant activity of warfarin, so they increase prothrombin time, but this kind of interaction is pharmacodynamic. Then we have drugs that decrease the prothrombin time, that means they have got opposite action to that of warfarin. Again, it can be pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic. Under pharmacokinetic, we have barbiturates and rifampicin. Barbiturates and rifampicin enhance the metabolism of warfarin. They induce the metabolism of warfarin, and the result is increased inactivation of warfarin, and that leads to decreased anticoagulant activity of warfarin. So that decreases prothrombin time. Whereas you all know that vitamin K is direct antagonist. It is a specific antagonist for warfarin. So it inhibits the action of warfarin. That means it decreases the prothrombin time by a pharmacodynamic mechanism. This completes anticoagulant drugs.